It's movie night. So many films start on the show tonight and so many great films to talk about. I'm here with my date, Dame Helen Mirren. I'm all set. I've got my popcorn, I've got my drink. All I need now is a snog with my date. Charming. Let's start the show! See you all. Thanks for being here. Great show tonight. Of course, the great dame herself is here, plus a host of film stars. I tell you, there are more stars on that sofa than a tax office in Panama. There really are. Not me. I did check. Did I do that? No, I didn't. Now, very exciting, because later on, we've got a real treat. Making his first appearance on the show, actor and Academy Award-winning director, Kevin Costner. Yeah. He's here. But who's coming on first? From slum to superstardom, this man has won BAFTAs, Golden Globes and Emmys and is one of Britain's greatest comedy exports. Please welcome Mr. Ricky Gervais! In his new film, Special Correspondents, this man is one of Australia's finest actors who starred in Munich, Star Trek, Troy, and Black Hawk Down. It's Mr. Eric Bana! Yes, he is! Hello! How are you doing? Nice to see you. Thanks for that. He went from Trainspotting to Moulin Rouge and Star Wars as the young Obi-Wan Kenobi. Now he's starring in the new Le Carre thriller, Our Kind of Traitor. It's Ewan McGregor, everybody! And it's a very warm welcome back to true acting royalty. It's the Tony, Emmy and Oscar winning Dame Helen Mirren! Yay! Lovely to see you. Come in, give it a good shout out. City. Oh,
very good. You all chose dark colours tonight. That was a good choice.
Yeah. You look lovely. You stand out. You stand out. Okay. And they're not overcrowding you there on the sofa, the boys.
I wish.
He made me move up, but I'm, yeah. I'm on a crack.
Move on down.
Someone told him he's the only one on.
There you go. No, because men like to do the man-spreading thing, which can crush a lady.
Yes, look, even here, I'm sitting nicely like this, my legs crossed.
Hello.
You are too.
Yes.
And they're all like, you know, my sofa.
Yeah. No, because Ricky Gervais, you have fallen victim of manspreading.
Well, it wasn't me. We were at the Knicks game in New York, basketball. We were right on the front row, great seats. This side of me was your mate, Hugh Jackman.
Right.
And
because he's from Australia.
Yeah. You'll live in the same, like neighbours. Yeah, you'll live in the same. And my girlfriend Jane was here, and next to her, Evander Holyfield came and sat down. Mm. And he's massive. And she went, his thighs are halfway on my... His thighs were like that, right? Now I'm squeezed up. And I said, I'm not going to say anything. Wolverine wouldn't have helped me, would he? It was massive, yeah. I don't need to spread. I've got tiny testicles.
But you see, I would have thought Eric and Ewan, because you both ride motorcycles, that you're kind of... You must be prone
like
to the man-spreading.
A saddle spread. I actually had an incident last week. I was at a football game and I had a foot spreader. I had a foot spreader next to me. And I actually found myself getting quite pissed off about it. Because he'd sort of invaded my space to the point that I couldn't adopt a neutral stance. I had to kind of like do that.
You wanted to spread.
I wanted to hit him and he buried the opposition. And I couldn't reclaim it. And it took until three-quarter time. I had to wait till he went to the bathroom and then I was like, oh, finally. I got my space. And he didn't return, so I couldn't actually claim the And he barracked for the opposition, so I just was trying to be nice.
Because now you and McGregor, see, the motorcycle thing, but also kilts, yeah. I would have thought would encourage man spreading.
Definitely not.
Well, why would you do that with a kilt on?
Well, you have to be careful with a kilt. Yeah.
But doesn't the sporran keep the middle down?
Yeah. But if you've got enough change in your sporran to weigh it down.
Is that a euphemism?
Foreign money,
change your fags, whatever.
I don't know that. Yeah. Like a little pocket.
It's like a little pouch.
It's just a look, you know.
No, it's a very practical thing. The original.
Yeah,
original fanny pack.
Yeah, it was a man bag. You said a man bag. Yeah. It's your traditional Scottish thing. It's a man bag. Braveheart and a man bag.
But the other thing is to touch people.
What?
Is to touch.
Different times. Different times.
Room.
Nice to see you out.
Lovely.
Hey.
Hi. How's it going?
You see politicians do this. You see them fighting to be the first one to touch the other one. Because touching...
That's a power thing, isn't it? Yeah.
If I touch Ewan, I'm not being nice to Ewan. I'm saying...
No, exactly.
It's quite nice.
That's quite nice to me.
Stop it. Please touch me again. Go on.
You know what I'm saying.
Have you a lot of change in your sporran now? Hey, we've got lots of movies to talk about tonight, so let's start with Dame Helen's new film, which is Eye in the Sky. I love this film. It's a properly kind of exciting, nail-biting drama about modern warfare with drones. It opens next Friday. Before we talk about it, this clip really kind of sets up the kind of central moral dilemma in that sort of warfare. You're the colonel.
One opportunity, let's not lose it.
Ma'am, she's selling bread.
Jesus. Those men are about to disperse. Engage now.
Ma'am, I understand we have clearance. I will fire if I see the ACIs moving or when this girl is out of the frag radius, but I want to give her a chance to get out of the way.
Lieutenant,
you have clearance. There is a lot more at stake than
you see here in this image.
Ma'am, I need you to run the collateral damage.
Estimate again with this girl up front.
The situation has not changed, Lieutenant. You are cleared to engage.
It's, you know, a lot of movies try to be tense.
That's tense.
This is, and it holds you for
the
whole
time. Yes, it does. It really does. It takes place in real time. The 2 hours that this operation takes to be completed is exactly the sort of the 2 hours of the movie. So,
and it's a kind of forensic examination of all the decisions that have to go into something.
Yes, extraordinary. I didn't know about this, and I think the majority of the audience won't understand. In a strike like this, specifically like this, this is exactly what would happen in terms of the chain of command, going all the way up to the Prime Minister if necessary, and nobody, as you see in the movie, quite wanting to make a decision.
Yes. And it's a great cast of Americans and British actors, and we must mention the late, great Alan Rickman, who is perfect in
this. Fantastic. It's
a brilliant, fitting final performance,
isn't it? It is. I think it's a movie he would be very proud of, in the sense that he would appreciate what the film was about and the way in which it tells its story. It doesn't take sides, incidentally. It makes no moral decisions. It just throws up the moral questions, but... But what I love about the film is it's Alan as I knew Alan. You know, I mean, he was a brilliant character actor, and we see him in Harry Potter and Die Hard playing these extraordinary characters. That is Alan as he really is, you know, funny, urbane, intelligent, very human. And so it's really great to see him up there.
Now, there is action in this film, even though, you know, you're in that room. But you have done kind of big action. You did the Red franchise stuff.
I did Red, yes.
And now I hear, I don't know if this is true, that you are gunning to be in a big action franchise.
Yes, Fast and Furious. I would love to be in Fast and Furious.
You're not joking, are you? Are you serious?
No. Of course, it's incredible fun to do those movies, aren't they? I mean, they're like, just, you don't act.
For you.
Now I'm interested. Yeah.
No acting required, and it's amazing. They set all these things, and things explode all around you, and oh, it's unbelievable fun. And that with cars, like, that would be my dream come true.
Because really. I didn't know you love cars.
I don't love cars.
You like driving?
I like driving. I'm not interested in cars as cars. You guys are, right? Some of you
yeah,
are.
Yeah, you're a racing driver.
Yeah, I love cars, but I don't ever want to do a movie where you pretend to race cars because that would drive me insane.
I'd like that.
I'd be very offended.
Oh.
There's a guy come over and say, now, you familiar with a manual transmission?
Yeah.
And ask that question. And...
But you can't... Can you not drive at all?
I know.
No, but do you know how?
Well, I've seen people do it. I don't
But you don't have a license.
Go. What?
You don't have a license.
No.
OK. You can't drink and drive, so what's the point? Well, that's kind of... That's sort of why I learnt. to stop myself drinking.
Really?
I got there'll be a couple of occasions when I can't drink.
Not worth it.
Because, Ellen, have you done the stunt driving in movies?
I drove stunt driving, believe it or not, in The Queen. It was...
Is there a lot of stunt?
That doesn't count as stunt driving, but I had to do a shot where, as my fellow actors will know, the cameras were set up all across the front of the car, so I couldn't see anything, and I had to drive like quite fast through country, not even made up roads, just back you know, tracks in Scotland. So that I think that sort of categorises as stunt driving.
Yeah, Fast and Furious, easy. Previous experience.
I also smashed a camera off the side of a car when I was stunt driving once.
Oh.
I totally forgot that it was on the side of the put on the side of the car, yeah. And I was on my own in the car, and I went round a corner really fast, but of course I forgot about the camera, and I completely smashed it off the total right off the camera.
We
were very
nice.
We've
got a lot to think about, though, haven't we? When we're put in cars and asked to drive with cameras in the way, and we're acting as well. There's quite a lot
and
to think
suddenly
about.
Suddenly, it becomes impossible to open the door.
Yeah, yeah.
Somehow, opening the door becomes real.
Do you know what I
really
can't?
Difficult.
What I can't do in a film is park a car. Yes. Like, I'm a good driver and I can park a car like the best of them.
All right.
But then there's a camera. But when there's a camera crew there, you can't park a car.
I was written up. I was parking
tough
a car.
Being an actor.
Yeah. The audience are going,
got it easy.
Oh, yeah. Poor thing. Yeah. Yeah.
Nurses, soldiers. Yeah. Try and park a car with someone looking at you.
Because Ricky and Eric, your new movie, Special Correspondents. Now, Eric, you did all your own driving in that, though, didn't you?
Yeah, there wasn't much. There was just one scene where we have a little getaway, and some people, you know, claim to be nervous passengers, and you kind of go, oh, yeah, whatever. I don't mind scaring them. But Ricky was so convincing, describing to me how scared
I'm
he
scared
is.
Of roads.
Really, really scared.
No, and seriously, so... I'm scared of roads and speed and all that. And guns, I'm scared of guns. And I had I had to shoot a gun and jump into a Jeep that he had to... I found out, I didn't even know he was a race car driver when I wrote the scene. And then that worried me. But he was really good.
I went the other way. I was like, he's going to really, really get scared here if I try and scare him. So I actually... I took it really easy on him, actually, because I was worried he'd go to his trailer and just not come back.
He drove with one hand and the other hand just comforting me.
Yeah. Man-spreaded. our knees were touching. I said, it's all right.
Well, you're making the film sound very exciting. Special Correspondents. Now, this is posh and new, ladies and gentlemen. It is released worldwide on Netflix on the 29th of April.
Exactly.
So, tell the people what it's about.
It's about... I play a bit of a radio nerd. I'm an engineer. Eric plays a handsome sort of... We flipped a coin. He plays the, the tall, handsome radio sort of news journalist. And I look up to him, but he thinks I'm an idiot, and he sort of bullies me. And we're thrown together, and we're meant to go and cover a civil war. But because I'm going through a really bad time, I lose the tickets and passport, and we have to sort of hide in a Spanish restaurant, and we're trying to work out how we get out of this. And I think this is you've got a clip.
We've got the clip of you and the people in the Spanish restaurant.
Yeah, we're trying to brainstorm how we get out of this situation now, because we're expected to do a report from Ecuador in a few hours, and obviously we're not there.
Here we go.
We need to brainstorm.
Brainstorm.
What is a brainstorm?
I love these two to bits, but they're not the sharpest tool in the box.
Where's your genius?
Could two other people go instead of you?
What? Of course not.
Can you cover a different story?
No, it needs to be that story, it needs to be Ecuador, and it needs to be us.
I got it.
Go on.
You could use someone else's passports. Ours.
Oh, we're screwed.
No, but she's...
Okay. You can save up money for new tickets, and by then, the passports will be here.
And the war will be over.
That's good, then.
Not for us.
Oh, but for the people. Less will die.
Less will die.
They're thinking of the people. Less will die.
You'll die, though. I'll kill you.
Hadn't worked together before, so Eric, how did you expect Ricky to be as a director?
I had no real expectation. I was just in shock that he knew who I was. I got a call saying, you know, Ricky's doing this project and blah blah blah, and you know, we'll send you the script. I'm like, oh yeah, you know, I'm a fan. I'd love to read what he's doing next. What's the point of me reading the script? They're like, no, he wants you to be in it. And I literally, I was like, does Ricky Gervais know who I am? Does he know I exist? I it was so bizarre. And and I read the script and it was terrible. but I was humbled by the fact that he knew who I was.
And I remember, I the reason I cast you was because I thought you were this sort of like really cool sort of brooding thespian. I saw you in Munich, and it was the Hulk and all this, and I thought it'd be great being an action hero, a bit screwed up. And on the first day, you said, did you cast me because you knew I did comedy? And I didn't. He started out in comedy in Australia in a very similar way to me. You did a little sketch show, and then you got your own show, and then you went and became a sort of handsome action hero.
Just like me.
It's exactly like me. No, but I didn't. And I found out he was an idiot like me. It was brilliant. No, he's not cool at all. He's a fucking idiot. We talked about nothing but our balls for about six. Is that true? Why did we? But in a funny Russian accent, I go, "Hello, how are your balls? My balls look good."
I don't know how that happened. It just morphed into. Why did it have to be Russian? He'd come to work and go, "And here comes Mr. Bannel with his big balls." And I'd be like, "And here comes Mr. Gervais with his suspiciously round balls."
Just go on a day. Is it because I found out you were Croatian?
Yeah, but not Russian.
I can't do any accents, but it doesn't matter to me. It just sounds different. That's it. He had to play American. I didn't want to play American. I made Kenny McDonald play American. Everyone was American except me. I just wrote in, he's from Reading.
So, you may not know that Eric Bana was a stand-up, but I didn't know that you, Helen, worked as a carny, like in a carnival.
Well, in the Kurzel in Southend-on-Sea, which sadly is closed now. But it was a fun fair thing.
Okay.
Permanent fun fair.
What did you do?
I worked on a dart stall, and I worked as a blagger to get the people to come to the dart stall, and so.
You seem a bit punched to do that.
She was common then.
I was common then, actually. Not really, but you know, I did live in Southend-on-Sea. Dublin. Southend-on-Sea is fabulous. It's Saint-Tropez. You know, the British Saint-Tropez. It is.
And how did you encourage people to play darts?
I'd shout at them incomprehensibly.
What would you say?
I'd say, excuse me, sir, excuse me, sir, sir, excuse me, did you blag in at the gate? Did you? No, I'm sorry, did you? Did you blag in at the gate? Because you have to, you know. You have to blag in at the gate. If you haven't, you know. I'll explain. If you could just come over here, I'll explain what it is. Did you blag in at the gate? Anyway, we've got a great stall here. We've got fantastic stall. So it was just to shout anything to get them to come over.
And that would work. Thing.
Yeah, because if you're asking a question, you know, people are, what did you say?
How weird were the men that they needed to be asked twice to come over to me?
Yeah, a beautiful lady, darts, what's not to like? Yay!
I assume it was rigged as well. Aren't they?
It was rigged? Just too... nobody ever won. Sometimes
that
you
sounds
feel
rigged
sorry
to me.
Now, guess what, everybody? As chance would have it, Ewan McGregor also has a new film out. Yes!
That's I didn't just pop by.
I feel a fool.
Don't feel a fool.
Well, no, I don't have one. Everyone else. Everyone's got a film. This one's called Our Kind of Traitor. It opens Friday the 13th of May. And, of course, John Le Carré, very hot right
yes.
now.
Yep.
After The Night Manager.
Exactly.
Now, this is another one of his thrillers.
Yeah.
Tell us who you are and what it contains.
It's about a story about a sort of everyday man. I play a professor, a teacher in a college in London who gets drawn into a sort of espionage plot between the British Secret Service and the Russian mafia. Stellan Skarsgård plays the sort of main Russian mafia
so
money
good.
Launderer. He's funny in
yeah,
it.
Yeah,
he's
yeah.
very, very
yeah.
good and brilliant. I like working with him a lot. It's a good story.
Is
a riveting good story. No.
He starts off funny. He starts off funny. He starts off funny, and then it. Yeah.
He's a funny man. No, he's funny to work with. Yeah. I mean, his character's not particularly funny. He kills quite a lot of people, but but in a funny way.
Yeah. But it's quite zeitgeisty because it's all about the new Russian money and all that sort of stuff. How different is it from the book, or do you know? Did you just get the script?
No, it's pretty close to the book, I think. I mean, the characters are somewhat... I was somewhat older in the book, I think, and not Scottish. I played him as a Scotsman, as opposed to an English person. But,
correct. Yeah. No point doing silly accents.
Let's have a look at a clip. This is you with your wife, played by Naomi Harris, being interrogated by Damian Lewis and realising that you're sort of getting out of your depth. In this
right.
situation. How'd you like to sit down? I have some questions. Not tough, medium soft. Is this all he gave you?
Yeah.
Didn't offer you any money?
Oh, he did, but I refused.
Then why did you bring it?
I thought it was the right thing to do. He said that his children would be killed if I didn't.
You believed him?
He seemed scared.
He told you he was a member of the Russian mafia. And you still agreed to help him. You haven't checked the contents of the memory stick.
No, no, I thought I could just hand it over and be done with it.
I thought that would be it, you know?
So, you got this movie out, and here's the thing. I didn't know, I don't know if you guys did, that, obviously, you were Obi-Wan Kenobi, but you're
you didn't know that.
No, that I knew. That I knew. But that you're in the new one. You're in the new Star Wars.
Well, hardly. I mean, my voice is in it for a second. I recorded a little line in it or something.
When do you speak?
I don't know.
Have you seen it? Have you seen it? Have you seen it?
I did, but I yes, I thought it was very good. I can't.
That line, excellent.
Yeah. You know that bit where there's a... I don't remember where I speak. No idea.
But very Alec Guinness speaks in it as well.
Yes. I think the beginning of the line is... The character's name is Ray. I'm really struggling here to try and remember. So I think the character's name is, of course, as you all know, Ray.
It is.
And so I wanted a line of dialogue that said, Ray. There's some other line that
yeah.
I say.
Yeah.
And,
Ray, these are your first steps or something.
What?
Ray, these are your first steps.
Or something.
Something.
That's what he said.
Something,
yeah.
something,
Ray,
something.
These are your first steps or something. That's
something.
Right, that's what he said. So they recorded me saying it, and then they found Alec Guinness saying, afraid. And they cut the A and the D off, and then they took the Ray out. So it's Alec Guinness saying, Ray. And then me saying that other line that you said.
Yeah.
Did you have to go all the way to Tunisia to do that? Or did you...
No. But it was obviously a very last-minute thing. I mean, J.J. Abrams emailed me out the blue. He got my email address from someone and emailed me, but it was about 2 weeks before the film was released. So it was obviously a sort of last-minute...
Yes.
Oh, yeah, let's... That might be a good idea.
Oh.
So anyway, it was nice. I was glad to be part of it. It was nice.
And very quickly, talking of iconic characters, Brent, David Brent is back.
He is.
Yeah. The new movie, David Brent, Life on the Road, we already know it's opening on the 19th of August.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the trailer was released yesterday.
Yeah, that's all we've got so far. It's Brent now, sort of 15 years later. We follow what he's doing. We find out what happened after the Office documentary went out and what he went through, and he went through a bit of a breakdown. Now he's selling sort of toiletry products as a rep up and down the country. But he never gave up the dream of being a pop star. And he's cashed in a few pensions, and he's worked overtime, and he's taken holiday. He's paid for a bunch of session musicians to go on tour with him. He's hired the venues, and he thinks he's going to get signed. And it's tragic.
And you posted some pictures of you getting into full Brent mode. There he is.
That's it. He makes a video called A Lady Gypsy about him losing his virginity when he was 18. So that's him trying to look 18.
And you've gone full hog, because it's not just a film. There is an accompanying album.
We're going to, bring out, it's 15, 20 tracks. seriously, of him, it's his dream come true. That is all these songs like Lady Gypsy and Native American and Equality Street, yeah? He's trying to change stuff. But, yeah, it's basically, he's a man out of time. It's really sort of, it's funny, but it's quite sad as well.
But Ricky Gervais, I'm guessing, is thrilled.
I'm nothing like him.
No, but you are thrilled to be bringing out an album.
Oh, I was a fan of pop music. Yeah, I sneak a song into everything I do. I wrote a song for The Simpsons. I wrote a song with David Bowie for Extras.
You wrote a song for Vera in Special Correspondents as
well.
Yeah,
she sings a song. I'm a frustrated, failed musician, so I suppose... It's great because I've got a get-out clause. It's sort of ironic, but it's still so much fun playing with a rock band, and they're really brilliant.
Yeah.
Andy from Razorlight and...
Wow.
Did you used to bring the guitar... When you were back in the day doing stand-up, were you one of those stand-ups who snuck the guitar on stage?
No, and... I'd never do that. Or get it out at a party. No, that's death. When someone gets that out of a party, death. Yeah. Forget it. We're going home. No. Did you?
No, and I always used to hate it when stand-ups did that.
I know.
Yeah.
It's like someone's like, fuck me, he's got a guitar. I know. Yeah. Tell a joke. Yeah. I know.
Ricky, can we look at a picture of you in your pop career?
Which one's which?
Is that you on the right?
On the right.
It is, yes.
Wow, look at that.
Yeah.
Wow,
that is a curious eyebrow. Wow. That is a kind of, well, what's going on over there?
What's the name of that? What's the name of that two-piece? What is that?
That's called Shauna Dancing. Let's move on.
What's it called?
See, I know what you're doing. You're going, oh, look at you there. I'm not embarrassed by that. I'm embarrassed by this. Everyone's going, what the fuck happened? I'll tell you what happened. Pizza happened.
Listen, you brought us a clip from David Brent, Life on the Road.
Oh, yeah, we get to know about his personal life a bit more, and this is him pretending that he's a bit of a Lothario, but, yeah.
I've been out with all sorts of girls. Rich girls, poor girls, white girls, you know, thin girls, fat girls. I went out with a very big lady, lovely, bubbly, beautiful eyes. All my mates were like, oh, Brent, if she lost weight, she'd be an absolute stunner. And she did lose weight, and she wasn't a stunner. That's very disappointing. A surprise to everyone. I think she left it a bit late in life and lost it way too quickly. So she was left with that sort of wattle thing. And she wasn't bubbly anymore. A bit grumpy. Always hungry.
Thank you. Oh, wow. Oh, thank you.
We look forward to seeing it. We do. Right, it is time to meet my final guest. This Hollywood legend has starred in so many of our favourite movies, from Field of Dreams, The Bodyguard, The Untouchables, to the Oscar-winning Dances with Wolves. Welcome, for the very first time to the show, Mr. Kevin Costner, everybody!
I feel like, you know, I mean, we always are entering everybody's living room, you know, mm-hmm. basically. So I've watched, admired, and laughed, and you're always kind of think better. I mean, Jesus Christ, why did I come on this show?
The others are thinking it. You've said it.
Stop. It really helped me a lot.
And what's nice is you've come out here tonight and you look like Kevin Costner. Yeah. Because well, no, because you were spending time in London, sort of in character for the new movie Criminal, where people were slightly taken aback by you.
Yeah, they were.
But like frightened of you, or?
Well, I play this part called Criminal. The only person it doesn't know about is my mom, you know, and I basically a pretty dodgy character and fierce, and I had to figure out how he was going to look, and he comes out looking like a little bit of a modern Frankenstein, if you will, a pretty fierce character.
Because this is the
like
look.
A chopper,
but this is the look, and did people not recognize
you? Amazing. Did you go out in London looking like that?
No, I put a hat on. I don't enjoy the. I know you. That exchange is like, no, you don't. And you just keep going.
But now this film, Criminal, which opens next Friday, you played Jericho Stewart, and we're used to seeing you as this sort of, you know, the clean-cut American hero, the good guy.
No, I know. No one ever mistakes me for anything other than an American. I get that. I make cowboy movies and baseball movies, and I've tried.
There's a little bit about the way you talk as well. Yeah.
But this guy isn't just a bad guy. He's kind of a monster. He's a proper monster.
I don't feel like I'm playing, but I feel like I'm playing somebody that people don't understand my problems. I don't feel like I'm bad.
Yeah.
I think that's the way you have to go about it.
Yeah. But in the film, there's a kind of a groundbreaking medical process.
Yes, we have a big leap of faith movie here. You know, we're going to have to transfer someone's memory into mine, and if we don't, the city's in peril. So if you make your jump over that, that's what happens.
I love it already. I love that. That's fantastic.
Yeah.
Someone puts a memory, someone else's memory in
I get Ryan Reynolds' memory. I get this.
They'll be great memories. They'll be good memories.
Yeah, I have a few myself. I get little flashbacks, and so the problem is that my character is not a controllable person, and so when he finally gets himself on the streets being a lifelong criminal, he realizes that people don't care about him. You know, everything that he does goes back to the street and how he survives in prison.
Like I say, it's open next Friday. This clip, this is you returning to the family home of Ryan Reynolds' character.
Of course.
So basically, you're in his basement, you've got his memories, and his wife finds you.
Yes.
Okay.
What are you doing in my basement? Did you work with Billy?
I don't think anyone like him ever would have worked with somebody like me. They stuck Billy in my head. I got a scar, see? All the stuff that he knew, all the stuff that he could do, I got it all scrambled up inside me.
It's impossible.
First car you two ever bought, used Rover. Bum clutch blew the first week. I told you, they stuck his brain in me.
That's enough. Just a second, baby.
Billy could never hurt you, Jill, so neither can I.
Here's the thing. When you were coming on the show, we were, you know, talking about your movies in the office, and not only is it lots of people's favourite movies, but for one actor, it's an extraordinary hit rate, you know, massive hit. And yet, when you think about them, films like Fields of Dreams, Dancing with Wolves, even a Robin Hood reboot, they're not obvious box office gold. How did you get them made? How did you pick them?
Well, some of them I actually had to put my own money into. I had to buy my own parts, actually. a lot of the movies that I've done, Field of Dreams, Bull Durham, Dancers with Wolves, were movies that were rejected by the studios. And Bull Durham somebody wouldn't give us $4 million for Bull Durham, and I ended up making like $300 million. And Dancers with Wolves was a movie that was turned down twice by the studios. I guess I didn't hear them the first time.
And you directed.
I directed it. And I've directed three movies, mostly stuff with horses. That's...
brilliant. I thought
you can't imagine how you inspire. I remember when Dances of Wolves came out, I was at drama school, and how inspiring it was for all of us to see that movie, to know that you directed it and acted in it. And for us, it blew our minds. Yeah. I remember very
Yeah, distinctly. That was a. I got to tell you, you know, we all have friends that, you know, you start with, and it's like, who gets there first, right? Who gets to the finish line? And then there's a lot of our friends behind us, and we find a way to try to help them if we can. And I remember one of my friends was a writer, and of course, I sent him on a lot of, you know, jobs, and every report that came back was he just pissed everybody off. And finally he came over, and he goes, you know, I hate Hollywood. I hate all you people. And I said, you know what? I tried to help you, man, you know? And I said, some of these people you're talking bad about are actually become friends of mine. And I said, you know, and I don't understand this whole thing about Hollywood. I said, maybe you're... Even though a writer always thinks the last thing they wrote is the very best thing they wrote, I said, maybe it's just not good enough. And he kind of said one more thing to me, and it just really crossed the line. And he's a kid from the 60s, so to speak, you know, a protest march or anything, and it's very easy to put Hollywood down. And he crossed the line with a friend of me, and I don't know what happened, but I had him up against the wall. And I said, look, I know. I did. I said, you know, would you just quit putting everybody down? I said, you know... quit writing things that are 120 pages long, because in our vernacular, that means a script. I said, and if you really want to write something that's 88 pages or 888. And I realized I had my hands on him. I sat him down. And I thought probably we had lost our friendship. And, of course, a week later, he says, hey, I don't have a place to stay. Could I stay at your house? So he stays there for a couple of months, and he's writing every night. He says, will you read what I wrote today? I said, fuck no. And this went on, and finally started reading to my daughter, who was like 3, every night. And finally my wife said to me, she said, look, he's in his room reading, he has to go. And I finally said, yeah, too much, you got to go. So away he went. He left what he had written, and he went down to Arizona, and he was working in a Chinese restaurant. If you've ever worked in a Chinese restaurant, washing dishes, there's a lot of them. And he called me, said, have you read it? Read what I wrote? I said, no, I don't really like you anymore. He goes, well, I'm cold. I'm working at this place, and I'm having to kill raccoons and work at this Chinese restaurant. And I said, so I sent him a sleeping bag. I sent him stuff. And he said, did you read what I... And finally, I read it, and it was Dances with Wolves.
No.
When you have that situation, somebody that, you know, you start with, I was never so proud of somebody. I said... You did it, man. You really, really did it. I said, I don't know how I'm going to do it, but I'm going to make it into a movie. And that was the story of actually a lot of my career. So many of those movies.
That's amazing.
Had to push them up to the point where I was...
It is an extraordinary
story.
Yeah. Yeah. And did he get an Oscar as well?
He did.
Amazing to go from killing raccoons and washing dishes to winning an Oscar.
It was already amazing before the punchline that you wrote.
Yes,
it was
absolutely.
It's like, I never help people. No point. Cut them off.
There's a thing in the DVD extras, there's a thing where you're directing the film, but there's a bit where you're having to direct wolves.
Yeah.
And you were having to, like, encourage the wolves.
Sit.
Yeah. Well, you know, I tell you, I remember when we got these wolves, there were real wolves, and I don't know, you ever think of, like, salesmen who, like, you know, carpet thing?
Vacuum
cleaner guy.
You're fired.
Yeah.
You're the worst salesman ever.
That's true. But you always see them, and they come into your house, and they throw ashes and jelly and shit like that, and they go like that, and it cleans it perfectly, and then you call all your friends over, and you throw the same shit on the floor, and the stain is there. And so when I met the guy with the wolves, he showed me how they would behave, you know, that he would push a button, and the wolf would come over here. Well, when I got out there, those wolves didn't do shit just like that. I was 10 days over schedule, 30 days into the movie, and they said, well, what are you going to do? I said, well, I'm not going to change the namesake of the movie. I got to figure out how to make
Dances with Dogs. So
you know, listen, when it's your money, you make everything, Hal. You make them, you know. It's no... It's
They like their belly being rubbed.
Do what you have
rubbed,
to do.
Apparently.
What's that?
They like their belly being rubbed. No, it's true.
Doesn't everyone?
Yeah.
Yeah, but these are real wolves.
Just
the real wolves do. Yeah. My girlfriend got me a present to go with these wolves. They weren't tame, but they were socialised. Yeah. And they were... No, that means they just don't kill you.
Yeah. Yet.
And they were huge, and they liked having their belly rubbed. I've tickled a wolf's belly.
Was it the belly you were tickling?
Animal trainer extraordinaire. Yeah. That is someone's job.
But Kevin, you were the...
You really broke
down that wall of actor-directors, right? I mean, you were the pioneer of that whole movement. I mean, we wouldn't have a Ben Affleck if it wasn't for the work you had done back then.
Well, thank you. It was a highlight for me to do, and I went out there, and I tell you what was really weird. My parents came to watch me, just like I did when I was a little kid playing sports. I used to be kind of embarrassed about it, but it was an interesting thing. I went out there my first day to direct, and my parents had took a trailer all the way to South Dakota, and they said, my mom said, we won't be in the way. We're not going to bother you, Kev. And I go, Jesus Christ, really, you're coming? And they go, yes, but we're not going to bother you. So I remember my first day of going out and to direct, and way up on a hill, my mom and dad had set a trailer and had their two lawn chairs, and my mom... and I was walking in front of the crew, and I said...
And obviously, we're all Kevin Costner fans here, but is it true, the story about getting the call from Stephen Hawking?
Yeah. Yeah, well, I did. I got a call from this guy.
How did you know it was him?
Yeah.
I thought I knew who he was, but he said he wanted to come see me, and so he comes in my driveway, big van, and they bring him out, and there's like nine people, and he comes into my living room, and I didn't really know how to talk to him. I mean, he has an IQ of 169. I have a 69 IQ. and you're trying to carry a conversation, but it was difficult, and finally, I just got a little hip to everything. I said, so what's up, man? What is it you want to know? Yeah, and he goes, well, and he wanted to know about Whitney and the bodyguard. And I said, well, no shit, then let's talk about that, because if that's what this wants to be about, then that's what we'll do. And that's what we did. So we talked about Whitney for a while. And then he said he was going to go dancing.
That is one of the oddest stories we've ever had on the show. But I love it.
This is amazing. Yeah. This is like a real chat show, like chat shows used to be. Yeah. If this were in America, we'd be dressed up as wolves dancing for a YouTube hit the next day. Yeah.
That's quite a good idea. Right there. Listen, Kevin, good luck with The Criminal. Thank you so much for coming to see us. Kevin Costner, everybody! Time. This Grammy Award-winning artist got into all our heads with a hit single, All About That Bass. Tonight, she's performing her new single, No. It's Meghan Trainor, everyone!
I think you're so cute, and I think you're so sweet. How you let your friends encourage you to try and talk to me. But let me stop you there. Oh, before you speak.
My name is no, my sign is no, my number is no. You need to let it go. You need to let it go. Need to let it go.
No, no, no.
My name is no, my sign is no, my number is no. You need to let it go. You need to let it go. Need to let it go. What you gonna say? You ain't running game. Thinking I'm believing every word. Call me beautiful, so original. Telling me I'm not like other girls. I was in my zone before you came along. Now I'm thinking maybe you should go. Blah, blah, blah. I'd be like, no, my
sign is no. My number is no. You need to let it go. You need to let it go. Need to let it go.
Here. Oh, yes, I have. So, that is the new single, No.
Right.
And that's out now.
Right now.
Yeah, okay. But the album, that's out on May the 13th.
Yeah, you can pre-order right now and get this song and another one. What?
She's on it. Meghan Trainor is on it.
Okay.
You've been exhausted after that.
Yeah, I'm so not in shape. I really barely did anything.
Yeah,
hi.
Yeah.
Whoa, what's up?
You should cut it.
I am in shape.
Yes.
This is the shape that I like.
Yeah.
All right, that's enough of that.
Thank you very much for coming to see us.
Thanks
I'm sorry we
me.
Can't chat more, but we're out of time. It's been an epic chat tonight. So that is it. I'm afraid no time for red chairs either. Please.
Oh, oh.
Shut up! Look at that!
Then why we come on.
Yeah. We didn't want to see them. We wanted to see a woman from Slough in a chair. Please, please say a huge, huge thank you to my guests tonight. Meghan Trainor! Ricky Gervais! Joe and Jake, actress Keely Halls, the charming Hugh Grant, and the great Meryl Streep. I'll see you then. Good night, everybody. Bye bye.
Nearly Naked Chef Hardy.